just like Mary, the sister of Lazarus, would sit and listen, will sit and listen. Speak to us through your Holy Spirit and touch our hearts. We thank you for everything that will be spoken in this place. We give you the glory, all the praises, all the honor. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. It is a great privilege to share the word of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If you could turn with me to your Bibles, to the book of Luke, Luke chapter 17. All the scriptures, we have read them, so there is no strange scripture. We have read everything in these Bibles. All of them are underlined and all the rest of it. Luke chapter 17. This morning we had a very good teaching from Pastor Faye. 911. You know, there's a joke about 911, this small one young person was cooking, and then the plate caught fire, and he was calling mom, on the phone. What is the number for 911? What is the number for 911? So today when the pastor was telling us, these are 911 numbers. But because God wants to see us to show faith, even if they are 911 numbers, there is another number we are given.
Yes.
Another number. Maybe it is a psalm. Maybe it is a gospel. Maybe that read this. That's where you will get your answer. So I would like to. We are going to share about the importance of the word. When Pastor Eli was singing, he was emphasizing the importance of the word. This morning, Pastor Faye was teaching the importance of the word. That is how we are going to survive on the word of God. It's only the word of God that will make us survive. If you would give a title to this teaching, short teaching, it is the days of Noah and the end of the world. And the days of Noah and the end of times. Hallelujah. In the gospel according to Luke chapter 17 verse 26 says, and as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be in the days of Son of Man. They did, verse 27, they did eat, they drank, they married wives, they were given in marriage until the day Noah entered the ark, and the flood came and destroyed them all. Destroyed them all. Which means they lived what they call the normal life. You know now what people say, oh, things should change and then we go back to normal. I can't wait to go back to normal. So they were living the so-called normal life.
Mm-hmm.
And that when they were caught up in that normal life, when the floods came, they were caught unawares.
Mm-hmm.
Hallelujah. Today, if you listen to some some teachings and some those who share, in the messages through the media, the TV, and all the rest of it, there are some churches today who do not take the study of the end times very seriously. There are people who say that, we see the end times. Why should I study about the end times? Because the rapture is coming, and I will not be here. That's just being selfish. If God knew that we were not in needed the education on the end times, He would have not. The Holy Spirit would have not inspired the writing of those the scriptures that we have in end times. And if we are going to rule with Christ, we should have already known about the end times,
yes.
how things are going to happen, and all the rest of it. So it is important for us. God revealed the details about the events in the Bible, that is so very important to us. And if you look at the teaching of the Word of God that has gone through the churches all these years, it is a little bit lopsided. There is a little teaching on the end times.
Yeah.
All the teachings about salvation, about the life of the church, which is the the epistles and the Old Testament, the prophets, the Psalms, and all the rest of it. But if you pay attention, you'll find that from the very first chapter in the Bible, the second chapter in the Bible, up to the end, is talking about end times. When they are talking about the judgment that would fall on the serpent, by that he said would be crushed, it's talking about the end times. Up to the whole Bible. So, but we do not pay attention on that. We find that one of the scriptures which are really the center of biblical teaching on the end times is Titus. Let me just read the Titus. Titus chapter 2. Let me read from verse 11.
Hallelujah.
To 13. For the grace of God that bringeth salvation has appeared to all men. The grace that has appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, seriously, and godly in the present world, looking for the what? The blessed hope.
Yes.
And the glorious appearing of the great God, our Savior.
Amen.
Jesus Christ. You see, this is the center. The end times message is the center of what? Of the biblical teaching.
Yeah.
We are waiting for the blessed appearance of Jesus Christ, the Savior, with whom we are going to spend eternity.
Praise God.
So the problem to many believers, why we run away from the books of the end times, like Zechariah, like Zephaniah, like Joel, like Daniel, like Revelation, all the books which talk about the end times, Ezekiel and all the rest of it, we run away because we have time to do everything that we want to do in the world. We have time to wash our clothes, to clean our homes, to do our hair and all the rest of it. Oh, I don't have hair. But we have time for all that, but we don't have time to sit down let the Holy Spirit teach us. You have to tell the Holy Spirit, let's go and study. And the Holy Spirit will teach you.
Yes.
Teach you the word of God. If you read the end times. But many people have run away from it because the complexity, and they say it is hard work because the scriptures are scattered from Genesis up to Revelation.
Mm-hmm.
But the Holy Spirit will help you to get all that, to work through the Bible and harmonize the details. They don't want it.
Yeah.
And some people sometimes they abuse the end times by trying to do all their things. Like they want to say, okay, the 21st is going to be the rapture. They should not be fixing it like that, because although it is end times, although the coming of Jesus is imminent, we should not just do foolish things like that. Or trying to, any current event, if there was somebody hears that, oh, there was a tornado that passed about 200 miles. Oh, the time, the world is ending. No, come on, you cannot join it just like that. Look, it shows lack of understanding of the scriptures.
Mm-hmm.
Hallelujah. So we are in the times when we should really take everything seriously.
Yes, sir.
And develop interest in the teaching of what? Of this end times. So for instance, the Bible has been, I sympathize with the Pastor Paul, because the Holy Spirit keeps taking him back to Matthew 24:25, back to Matthew 24. He tries to run away, the Holy Spirit keeps on taking him back. Why? Because he has anointed him to talk about that. He's the only one who can really go through those scriptures, and you see they stand out.
Mm-hmm.
Because he's faithful, the Holy Spirit gives it to him. Hallelujah. So the days of Noah, as the Bible tells us, are completely joined to what? To the what? To the end times.
Amen.
They are joined to the end times. And as we will try to see quickly in the scriptures, although I'm going to go through many scriptures, it is important for us to to know why Jesus referred to the end times. I was wondering, why did he refer to the time of Noah, the days of Noah? Because there are certain things that are hidden in it, in that time, that can open the scriptures for us to know the end times better. In Genesis chapter 6, Genesis chapter 6, let me just read verse 1 to 3. It says that, "And it came to pass that when men began to multiply on the face of the earth, the daughters were born unto them. And the sons of God saw the daughters of men, that they were fair, and took them wives of all which they chose. And the Lord said, My spirit shall not always strive with man, for that he also is flesh. Yet the day is day shall be 120 years." Mm-hmm. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The understand this chapter is foundation. It is a foundational necessity to what? For us to understand the old, the Bible and the Old Testament and what? And the prophecy. The Bible is here telling us about the sons of God. Mm-hmm. Tells us about sons of God. Sons of God are those creations which God physically created, like angels. He created angels one by one.
Yeah.
He created Adam. Those creations that he created, those are the sons of God.
Mm-hmm.
Even God, the Bible tells us in the book of Job, God always has a meeting and calls them and they go.
Yeah.
And Lucifer was one of them. Satan also attends the meetings.
Yeah.
Yeah. So here they say that the sons of God, who are the angels, they came and took the daughters of men that they chose. Which means they came and looked. The daughters of men were very beautiful, very fair. And they picked specifically the ones which they want. And they took them as wives. The women did not have a voice about it. They were taken by force. They were taken by force. So they took them as wives. I hear some other people, some brothers say, brothers and sisters who said, oh, you see, they came, the angels came and married daughters of men. They did not marry. The Bible is very clear about marriage. It says that who marries people is only God the Father. The ministers will come and represent. That's why you see ministers are very dignified when they come to bring people together in marriage. Why? They are representing God the Father. That's why the scriptures say, whom God has put together, let no one put asunder. Why? Who marries people? God the Father. It's not the ministers. The ministers are there because they are supposed to be there. They are the hands of God. So here, you cannot say that the angels married the daughters of men. They came, the Bible is very clear, took by force. The women didn't have a choice about it.
Yeah.
And they took them. The Bible calls the sons of God, Ben Elohim. Those are direct creation of God. The Bible calls us, I was explaining to Sister Eunice last time, that in Swahili it's called Bin Adam. We are called Bin Adam, which is the children of Adam. She was surprised. She said, I didn't know. She always used Bin Adam, but she didn't know it was connected to the Bible. But they came and they took the daughters of men. We are what? We are the creation of God, but we are children of Adam. If you read in the scriptures, it will tell you that.
Yes.
It will tell you that we are the children of Adam. We are not directly from God. And so the daughters that were what? That the disciples came and took away were the daughters of men.
Yeah.
Daughters of men.
Amen.
In Genesis chapter 5, verse 3 will tell us. It tells us that, "And Adam lived 130 years and begat sons and his, in his own likeness after his image. He begat sons after his own image, and he called his name Seth. After his own likeness, after his own. So when Seth was born, it was what? He had already the defects of Adam.
Yes.
The sin of the sin that was placed on Adam, that fell upon Adam, it just was transferred. The Bible is very clear about that. It tells us that okay, through one man, everybody, all the human beings fell, but through another one, the second Adam, we were born again.
Yes.
That's why that's what the Bible says. So it is only Jesus, according to the book, the gospel according to John, it is Jesus who brings us back to become who? Sons and daughters of God. We are the children of God.
It is, amen.
Yes. In John chapter 1, verse 11 and 12, say that he came unto his own, and his own receiving not. But as many as received him, to them he gave the power to become who? Sons of God, even them that believe in his name. So Jesus is the one who makes us. So if you hear the pastor call us that children of God, it's because you are believers. Not because you were born by Adam. Because if you were through Adam, it was you are not a child of God. According to Genesis 5:3, which we have read. Hallelujah. So when they took these daughters of men, they went and produced the what? Giants. Mm-hmm. They gave birth to Nephilims. Yeah. The Nephilims, which I call the fallen ones. It is also translated as gigantes. But it was wrongly translated as gigantes. They were giants, but they should have not called them giants, gigantes, because in Latin it is gigantes means lion, giants. So they gave birth to these Nephilims, but these Nephilims were big giants. And what happened to them? They in what? In their turn, these giants in turn intermingled with the creation of the earth. All the creatures that God has created on earth, and they gave birth to hybrids, what they call the Hagiborin, which means the mighty ones, the mighty ones of the earth, the earthbound people. Such that when the floods came, these hybrids that were born between the giants and the creatures were destroyed. Were destroyed. So the angels come, married to take the daughters of men, produce giants. The giants then get into violence, start raping all the creation, and they produce what? The hybrids. So God says that these hybrids, what he was going to destroy them, because God's creation was what? It was perfect. In the book of Jude, the book of Jude tells us, hallelujah. Book of Jude is one chapter. In verse 7 says that, let's read 6. And the angels which kept not their first estate, but left their own habitation, he has reserved for everlasting chains under darkness unto the judgment of the great day. So these creatures, these angels, they left their habitation. The Bible calls it in Greek, it is oikiterion. That's what they left. They went for strange flesh.
Yes.
Strange flesh. They abandoned their habitation. They came and took over how we were clothed. We were clothed. Just as we are clothed with the flesh. The Bible tells us that we cry out to be what? To be clothed with what? With the body from heaven. But they left the body from heaven, their habitation, and came and got clothed with what? With the human sinful body.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So they degraded themselves and got themselves into what? Into problems, because they were, when all of them were captured, and all of them are jailed in different places on earth here. Different places. In 1 Peter 3:20. Also tells us that which were, they talk about the spirits, that we sometimes were disobedient when once long suffering of God waited in the days of Noah, while the ark was preparing, wherein few, that is, eight souls were saved by water. And if you move to the 2 Peter 2, it will tell us in verse 4-5 that, for if God spared not the angels that sinned, but cast them down to hell, and delivered them into chains and darkness to be reserved for judgment, and spared not the old world, but saved Noah, the eighth person, a preacher of righteousness, bringing in the floods upon the world of the what? Of the ungodly.
Yeah.
So this is what happened. God decided that he was to go and to get away with God going to do away with what?
Yeah.
With the creatures, these ugly creatures, and the disobedience angels were chained in darkness. The Bible teaches that they were chained in a dark abode of war, which means Tartarus. Tartarus is a wild place which you do not even want to think about it. The teaching says that it is below what? It is below Hades, as far as heaven is to earth. In order that when you go to hell, and you are put where these angels are in prison, you will feel as if you are a distance, such a deep distance, that it will be the same distance from us to going to heaven is also you from hell going into the depth. That's how far they are. They are far, far away, below heads. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. But the word of God then later on comes and teaches us that God does not like intermingling of what? Of creation with what? Intermingling of creation, because God wanted each group to be completely separate, each flesh to be separate. In Genesis chapter 6, let me read verse 11 to verse 13. It says that the earth was corrupt. The earth also was corrupt before God, and the earth was filled with violence. There was a lot of violence. You see now, if you go to, for example, you look at the news, you'll find that the people are breaking and getting into the shops. They come in a big group, breaking and going and steal everything. And violence is coming out in our midst. But we are so numb that we don't even notice that. The earth was filled with violence, and God looked upon the earth, and behold, it was corrupt. For the flesh had corrupted his way upon the earth. And God said unto Noah, all flesh is come before me, and the end of all flesh has come before me, and the earth is filled with violence through them. And behold, I will destroy them with the earth. God has decided to destroy everything. God has decided to destroy everything. Somebody challenged me about that. I said, we don't argue on the word of God. If you want, you better go and read the Bible and see exactly.
Come on. Yeah.
and see exactly. Because this, when these giants intermingled with the creation, they brought things that when we read in the book of Revelation, we get scared to read the book of Revelation. Why? Because all the book of Daniel, when the book of Daniel we read it, you'll find that they become completely scary. Very, very scary. But here we will find that God forbade any intermingling between the human being and all the creatures. He told Adam, there was no companion for Adam. He decided to make one for Adam. But he would not allow Adam to intermingle with what? With the creation. He would not allow that. And because out of that, the problems entered into the earth. Problems have entered into earth. So, hallelujah, in the book of Leviticus, let me read Leviticus chapter 18. It tells us in verse 23. It tells us that they were teaching the Israel moral laws which they were supposed to follow when they reached the promised land. The verse 23 says that neither shall thou lie with any beast or defile yourself therewith. Neither shall any woman stand before the beast to lie down. Therefore. It is confusion. You see, the Bible is saying it is confusion. No intermingling is supposed to happen between any other creation with the human creation. But this is what was happening during Adam's time, and these things are happening even up to today. God, when you read all the continual reading chapter 19, he will be telling you one thing that. God said that God is in one way is saying that, you see, I would intervene, but I cannot. The earth is vomiting those people out. Those people whose land you are going to occupy when you reach the promised land, they are being vomited out by the land. But if you people also go down there and you start intermingling with the animals and all these creations, the land will vomit you out. Will spew you out. So it is the land that automatically will judge before even God moves. So God was warning them that don't do what the people in those lands are doing. They are being thrown out. Why? Because they are abomination. They are intermingling with the human genes with other creatures, which is prohibited. Hallelujah. Because those things will not only create hybrids, but it caused a lot of sicknesses and viruses. The sicknesses and viruses we have today is because there is intermingling between people and animals.
True, sir. Amen.
Bad flu. Yeah. Where does the bad flu come to attack human beings? It's because our genes are intermingled.
Yes.
Mad cow disease. How do we get mad cow disease? It's because the genes of the animal are mixed with ours. You see, the porcelain flu, which is the pig or pigs and animals and all that. When they cross like this, it affects us. It affects us. So God was trying to protect us. God is trying to protect us. So you find that then God said they have to be destroyed. That was the only solution, to destroy them and start afresh. So people who say, oh, it was unfair when God told Joshua that when they reach down there, they should still kill all the animals, all the people, all the children, all the white women, because they were contaminated. If Israel were to live with these people, some of these people, they would also get these genes, and Jesus Christ would not come. Jesus Christ would have not been born. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So in Genesis chapter 6, verse 4, there's a key there. There were giants in the earth in those days. Where did the giants come? The angels mixed with men, mm-hmm. with the human, with the creation, with the human beings. And also after that, why does the Bible say that? And also after that, why? Because the Nephilims that appeared, they did not end up with the floods. When the floods of Noah came and destroyed them, the Bible is telling us that. And also after that, the giants appeared again.
Yeah.
They appeared again. So we when we read that, it confuses us. They appear again. By the time Israelites came back and into the promised land, the whole of that promised land was covered with what? With the giants. It was covered with the giants. You know, I used to think just thinking without reading, until when I read and I found out. When I was reading, I said that, wow, the other 10 spies who went with Joshua and Caleb, they were telling lies. They were not telling lies. They were not telling lies. We, as we will see. So in the book of Numbers, Numbers chapter 13, verse 28 to 33, the Bible of God says, the word of God says in verse 28, nevertheless, the people, hear what they say. Nevertheless, the people be strong that dwell in the land, and the cities are walled and very great. And moreover, we saw the children of Anak there. Those are the what? The giants. The Amalekites dwell in the what? In the land in the south, and the Hittites and the Jebusites and the Amorites dwell in the mountains, and the Canaanites dwell by the sea and by the coast. All these nations were headed by giants. They were headed by the giants. If let's jump to verse 23. And there we saw the giants, the sons of Anak, which came of the giants, and we were in our own size like grasshoppers, and so were they in what? So we were in their sight. They saw themselves as giant, as grasshoppers, and these people also saw them as grasshoppers. But if you go to verse 30, it tells us something very important. Very important. Say that. And Caleb still the people, when the people were confused, he still people before Moses and said, let us go up at once and possess it. For we are well able to what? To overcome it. Caleb is not saying these people are telling lies. No. He's saying, let's go. He has faith. God who brought us and to ride for us the Red Sea and looked after us in the desert, he will help us. I know they are giants. Those people are giants. There were giants everywhere. I know people. Those people are giants, but we were well able. Joshua didn't even say it because Joshua knew they had seen giants.
Yeah.
They have seen giants. But because we do not have time, let me just go to Deuteronomy chapter 2. In Deuteronomy chapter 2, it tells us a little bit, verse 9 to 12 says, and the Lord said unto me, distress not the Moabites, neither contend with them in battle, for I will not give thee the what? Their land for possession, because I have given Ar unto them, the children of Lot, for possession. The Emims dwelt there in time past. The Emims were giants.
Yes.
And the people, the people great and many and tall as the Anakims. You see? Mm-hmm. Which also were accounted giants. And the Anakims, and as the Anakims, but there were Moabites called them Emims. There were Emims. And then in verse 12, the Horims also dwelt in Mount Seir. Who took over Mount Seir? Esau. descendants of Esau. But God managed to, God took them and they destroyed these giants there. Yeah. So the whole place, Satan was putting a minefield, the whole place, every group was being headed by what? By giants.
Yeah.
There were giants everywhere.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
All the promised land was full of them. In Joshua. Joshua chapter 6. Hallelujah. Let me just see. Can you see that? Joshua also killed the giant. But in Joshua chapter 6, verse 21 says, this is where Joshua was commanded to destroy everything. The word of God says, and they utterly destroyed all that was in the city after the in Jericho. Both man and woman, young and old, ox and the sheep and the ass and with the edge of the sword. Why? Because this creation carried terrible genes.
Yes, sir. Man.
They had totally to be destroyed. All these living creations.
Yes.
Just to protect Israel.
Mm-hmm.
To protect Israel, they had to be destroyed.
Yes.
It is a problem of genes. A problem of genes.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Mm.
So here God was protecting Israelites from what? From all these hybrids that was down there. But you say, but Brother Paul, I thought the floods came and wiped out what? Wiped out the creation. Yes. In Genesis chapter 6, verse 11 to 13, the word of God says that. It talks about the corruption of the earth. We already read that. Let's read the hallelujah. Leviticus 18. We have already read Leviticus 18 also, that so the intermingling of the human genes with the other creatures, God does not allow it. God does not allow any intermingling between these creatures with what? With the human beings.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
So in let's go to Genesis chapter 7. Genesis chapter 7. Genesis chapter 7 tells us in verse 21. Let's read to 23. Verse 21 to 23 says that. And all the flesh died. This is when the floods came. All the flesh died upon the earth. Both the fowl and the cattle and the beast of every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth and every man. And all in whose nostrils, are you listening? All in whose nostrils was breath of life, and all that was in the dry land died. Pay attention. And every living substance was destroyed, which was upon the face of the ground, both man and cattle, and the creeping things and the fowls of heaven, they were destroyed from the earth. And Noah only remained alive, and they that were with him in the ark. This is a little difficult to figure out. But what the word of God is saying here, that all flesh that breathe through the nostrils, that walk on land, were destroyed by the what? The water of the floods. The Bible does not tell us that Noah did take an aquarium and put the fish in what? In the ark. No, he didn't do that. He did not do that. So God protected, he protected us. All the flesh that was breathed through the nostril, walk on the land, fly in the air, and all those were completely different. They destroyed. Man, cattle, creeping things, fowls, all were destroyed. All the Bible tells us that there are different kinds of flesh. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 39 tells us there are so many different kinds of flesh. There's flesh for let's just read it. First Corinthians chapter 15, verse 39. Verse 39 tells us that all the flesh is not the same flesh, but there is one flesh, one kind of flesh of man, another flesh of beasts, another flesh of fish, and another flesh of birds. So when we read about the animals which were having the breathing through the nostrils, going on the land and all the rest of it, those ones were destroyed. But the fish were not destroyed. Why? The fish breathe through their gills. Yeah. They open their mouth and the water goes through and they can get oxygen through their gills, get the oxygen. And they were staying alive. The only thing that happened to the fish, all the fish that were in the sea were pushed deep into the depth. Yeah. God pushed them into the depth purposely. He pushed them into the depth. There was a time many years ago. There's a time when the spirit moved, and we used to have this place was packed for the Bible studies all the time. So the Lord moved the pastors and gave them to teach on what? On marine spirits, water spirits. When they told the first Tuesday, everybody was there, the whole place was packed. The second Tuesday, we were only half. The third Tuesday, we were about only 10. We would remain. Everybody got offense and moved away. But that was what God wanted to be taught at that time. There are a lot of animals, a lot of creatures. These creatures were not destroyed with the floods. The one which lived in the water. The hybrids, yeah, who mix with the animals, yeah, who mix with these giants, and produces mermaids and other things, other water creatures. Those went deep under. Why? Because God kept them. God kept them. They went deep into the sea. Such that I was wondering, let's just move to the book of Daniel. One of the books of the end time books. It talks about the end times, teaches about the end times. And no, we ran away from Daniel. And Pastor Paul took time sometimes and he taught the Bible studies on Daniel. But it was the people, some caught offense and all that, but it is fine. He told about Daniel. We got a book of Daniel. Let's go to Daniel 7. In Daniel 7, verse 1 to 8. Okay. Oh, let's Daniel 7. Let's read from verse 2. Daniel spake and said, "I saw in my vision by night, and behold, the four winds of the heaven strove upon the great sea." The winds were blowing over the sea. Four great beasts came up out of the sea, diverse one from the other. Verse 4. The first was like a lion, and had the eagle's wings. That's a mixture. Yeah. And I beheld the wings thereof, and they were plucked, and it was lifted up from the earth. and made to stand upon the feet as man. He's now standing like a man. This lion standing like a man. And he has the wings of the eagle and all the rest. The man's heart was given unto him. You see, these are the where did it come from? From the sea.
Yeah.
The hybrids that God sent deep, they are kept for the last time, for the end times.
Yes, sir.
So when you read that in the book of Revelation, you get scared. Let me tell you, if you want, you go to the eastern part of the world, where you find that there are people where they worship many gods.
Yes,
you can find the statues of God. The whole body is a woman, and the head is of elephant,
yes.
And the feet are completely different.
Yes.
You find they have statues of those things.
Yes.
Those are the gods they have down there. The Hindus and all the rest of it, the people who follow all those religions, they believe in those. Why? Because those things are real. When they visit the supernatural, they see them and they come and make the sculpture of those. If you go even to the Buddhists and you see a Buddha, behind there's a place open whereby these evil demons go into that Buddha statue and things change. So these things are real.
Yes, sir.
So because God wiped the ones which were on earth so that we do not get frightened, when we are already taken to heaven, when we come to rule with Jesus, and when we see a thing like that,
hey.
you are not frightened. Why? Because you already know about it. It's the Holy Spirit gave us in the Bible. So when people say, oh, the end time books are mysterious, and they're weird, and all the rest of it, we can't read them, you can't understand them. No. The Holy Spirit gave us, and we have been told that in the book of Revelation, chapter 1, verse 3, tells us that if you read this book, you are blessed. If you hear it being read, you are blessed. If you practice what is being taught in it, you are blessed. So is that what the book you are going to stop people from reading? That, oh no, no, in our church we are not going to read the book of Revelation. It is too confusing. Or it talks about weird stuff. No. That book tells us at the beginning, in the first chapter, that we'll be blessed if we read it, if we study. Hallelujah. So we should not be afraid. We should use the word of God and prepare ourselves just for what? For these difficult days.
Right. Yeah.
Amen.
Hear what it says in Daniel 7 verse 5. It tells us. And behold, another beast, a second, like the bear, and it raised up itself on one side, and it had three ribs in its mouth and between the teeth of it, and they said thus unto it, arise and devour the many flesh. After this I beheld, and lo, another like a leopard, which had upon its back four wings. It's a hybrid mixture. The beast had also four heads. And the dominion was given to it. And verse 7 tells us, and I saw in the night vision, and behold, the fourth beast, dreadful and terrible and strong exceedingly. And it was great. It had iron teeth, and it devoured and broke in pieces and stamped stamped the residue with its feet of it. And it was diverse from all the beasts that were before it, and it had 10 horns. These hybrids, the mixtures, the ones which were on land were wiped out in the flood, but the ones which went into the water,
right.
They are marine spirits. They have been left for what? For the last days. They will come out in the last days.
Yes.
They will come out in the last days. So do not forsake the word of God. You go and read it. God wants you to know about it. Because if you are going to rule with Jesus, and the first day when you see an animal like that come, a creature like that come out of water, you will run.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus said that heaven is not for the cowards.
Yeah.
Those who are the fearful, the effeminate, and all the rest of it, it will not inherit the kingdom of God.
That's why you are being told that you can read that thing, read them and know about them. In looking in Revelation chapter 9, verse 7 to 10, and say that, and the shapes of the,
he talks about the locusts now coming from the ground. Those are also imprisoned in the what? In the ground. But the door is open for them.
And the shape of the locusts were like unto the horses prepared for battle. And on their heads were the what? As it were crowns of gold. And their faces were as faces of men. And they had the hair and as the hair of the women. You see, they have long hair. And their faces like men. And their teeth were like the teeth of lions. These are hybrids. And they had the breastplates as if it were the breastplate of iron, and the sound of their wings. You see, they have wings. And was as the sound of chariots of many horses running to battle. And they had tails like the scorpions.
You see now, how far they are mixed.
And the stings of their tails, and their power was to hurt men for 5 months.
You see, these creatures were in water, but they are being brought out for what?
For the end times. God wants us to know about them.
Amen.
So do not forsake the word of God. Say, that is the word of God is very complex. The word of God is scary and all the rest of it. No, you read this with the Holy Spirit. Say, the Holy Spirit, teach me.
Mm-hmm.
Teach me.
Amen.
In chapter 13 of the book of Revelation tells us, and I stood, chapter 13, verse 1, and I stood upon the sand of the sea, and I saw the beasts rise up out of the sea.
Where did the beasts come? From the sea. They are hidden there.
And having seven heads and ten horns, upon his horns, ten crowns, and upon his head, the name of blessing. You see, this, where is it coming from? From the sea. And the beast which I saw was like a leopard. And his feet were the feet of a bear. And his mouth was the mouth of a lion. And the dragon, oh Lord, and the dragon gave him his power and his seat. And the great authority.
You see, coming out of the sea, that is where they were put.
Yeah.
They were not destroyed by the water of the floods. They are in the sea. They cannot be destroyed. Why? Because they breathe with the gills like fish.
They breathe with gills like fish. God is going to use them in that last time. Those are the locusts. That's the beast of the sea. You will find it in chapter 16. Chapter 16. You will find that now what the judgments that will be done. The balls will be poured. In chapter 16, verse 3, say that, and the second angel poured out his vial upon the sea, and it became as blood of the dead man, and every living soul in the sea died.
They will be destroyed. Why? Because when Jesus comes to rule for 1,000 years, those evil creatures will not be there. They will be destroyed.
Amen.
So the vial is poured into the sea, and everything turns into blood.
Everything turns into the blood, and you hear the verse 4. And the third angel poured his vial into the rivers and the fountains of water, and they became blood. Yeah, you see, those ones who are in the rivers also are destroyed, and the ones even in Euphrates, that is in the verse 12, tells us that those in Euphrates were also destroyed. Say that, and the sixth angel poured out his vial. The sixth angel poured out his vial upon the great river of Euphrates, and the water thereof dried up. And that the way of the king of the east might be prepared.
So don't get confused about the way of where these armies will come through. But we are focused on one thing. These creatures, these sea hybrids, they have to be destroyed. They have to be destroyed. So in when, that's why if you move to Revelation chapter 21, it tells us that, and I saw a new heaven and a new earth. Everything is going to be renewed. And for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no more sea. You know, I remember when I used to hear the teachings, they would say, wait a minute, when there has been no more sea because people will not be dying, and then we will be needing more places to grow food. Come on, God plans better than that. It is God who is planning. There will be, when we leave, we will not be eating to live. We'll be eating to celebrate, to feast.
Amen.
It's not that every day you are going to eat. You will not depend on any food. Mm-hmm. So people who say that they do not know what is happening here, they're cleansing heaven, they're cleansing the earth, and they're cleansing the sea. The seas dry. When the sea dries, these hybrids, which breathe through the gills like the fish, die. Why? Because they have no water to breathe through. So those who were destroyed from Noah's time, will be the remnants will be destroyed where? In the last days. In the last days. So when Jesus refers that, okay, it was like the days of Noah, it's what it will be with the coming of the man, that the cleansing will continue. The cleansing will continue.
Praise God.
So when the Bible tells us that anybody who reads these words and keep them and hear it, you are blessed. You are blessed.
Amen.
Hallelujah. So it is time when we are going to the vacation now. It is time for you to get into what? Into the teachings. In the teachings of what? Of the end times. Read the book of Revelation. Read the other books that talk about it. The book of Daniel. It was taught very well here, but I don't know if we could in future, Pastor Paul, if the Holy Spirit guides you, if we could get all those teachings ready for people, that would be fantastic. That would be very, very important. Hallelujah. We need to know these words. Why? As Pastor Paul preached this morning, we need the Word of God. As Pastor Eli was singing and preaching, talking here, that we need the Word of God. Why? Because the Word of God in these difficult days, the end times, is a lamp unto our feet and was a light unto our path. We need the Word of God. You need, for example, you say that the book of Revelation is confusing. Listen. I have the method of teaching, which my mother used to be a grade one teacher, I used to stammer and couldn't talk. She said, "Paul, break up the word, break it into pieces." That is what the word. When I was preparing this message, something came into me and said, "Tell the brethren that they can break the word, break the book into pieces." For example, in the book of Revelation, the first part, you can pick the first three parts. Those are what the message about the church.
Mm-hmm.
The second one, which chapter 4 to chapter 5, is introduction to what is going to happen. And then in chapter 6 to 19, the events of the tribulation. And when you go to chapter 20, it talks about the 1,000-year rule. And when you go to chapter 21 and 22, he's talking about the newness of the things that are created, the new estate that is created. The book of Revelation is finished.
Yes, sir.
Break it into pieces. Break the books into pieces. Take your time. Nobody is screaming at you that today you have to finish the Bible. No, 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 no. Read. Ask the Holy Spirit, help me to understand this. If you had written the 911 numbers which Pastor Pei was giving us, those are very important. That's how we are going to survive, the Word of God. The Word of God. It will be the lamp unto our feet.
Hallelujah.
And a light unto our path.
Mm-hmm.
So I want to leave that with you so that it goes into you, say that
Holy Spirit, help me to learn how to read the Bible.
Amen.
If you have difficulty, you have difficulty in reading and understanding God's law.
Mm-hmm.
Read. Just read and say, the Holy Spirit, let's read the Bible. You may not understand at the beginning, but you'll pick it up. Because you are interested, your spirit, Holy Spirit and the spirit man will say, oh, this person is interested. Because God challenges us, and when he sees that we are interested, then he will anoint us to continue with our callings. But if he calls us and we do not go forward, we don't get the anointing for going forward. So Jesus tells us that just as in the times of Noah, he's referring to that. The things that were happening in the time of Noah are happening even today.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. Are happening even today.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Praise God.
They're happening even today. So if the Lord tarries and he takes you to different parts of the world, like you go to Africa, you go to the East and all the rest of it, you will learn about things that like the water spirits, how they come out. They can socialize with the people. They can live with the people, and they go back down there. If you would want to follow, the Bible tells us that when the Israelites came, for example, and they reached the promised land, all the land by the coast, Gaza. Where was the Goliath from? From Gaza. Yeah, near the water. The water spirits that were coming from the other giants who were from a little bit from the north, where the Phoenicians came, they mixed with the Phoenicians and the Assyrians and all that place. And the giants covered all the promised land. They covered all the promised land. Israel destroyed them.
Yes.
The children of Lot destroyed them. God helped the children of Lot.
Mm-hmm.
The children of Esau and Ishmael destroyed what? God went before them and destroyed what? All those giants.
Mm-hmm.
So do not fear. Do not fear. Stand on the word of God.
Amen.
God, let's take it into our hearts that this year, the end of this year, I will focus more onto the word of God.
Amen.
And we will be blessed and we'll be protected. Do anything that is happening outside, when we stand on the word of God, remember the 911 numbers. Call those numbers and it will be fine with us.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
I believe you have received from the word of God.
Yeah.
And you can see now how Jesus was talking, going backwards, telling us that, just like the time of Noah. Exactly. The things that we are doing is just like in the time of Noah. And you find that the things in the time of Noah, which we thought were over, are still continuing today. Hallelujah. Praise God. Let's get on our feet and we'll close at this time. I believe you have received from the word of God.
Yes.
Thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you even at this time. Hallelujah. For the word that has spoken unto your people. The word of God that has been read from the word of God, from the Bible, O Lord. We ask that strengthen your people. Strengthen us even in this difficult time. We will stand on your word because your word is yea and amen to those who believe. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And we all will be well with us until the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Lord.
Hallelujah. We give you the glory, all the praises, all the honor as we go our separate ways, Lord. Cover everybody with this blood of Jesus. Those, wherever they are, cover them, O Lord. So that when they, wherever they go, let the blood of Jesus repel any evil that is outside down there. And strengthen the hearts of your people. Hallelujah. Until the coming of the Lord Jesus.
Yes.
The Lord bless you and keep you.
Amen.
May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you.
Amen.
May the Lord lift up his countenance unto you and give you peace in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Praise God.